In one of his best-known songs, Jimi Hendrix asks us, "Are you experienced?" We're going to talk about experience as represented today on your resume, and we'll also talk about negotiating a salary after your resume is done. The word resume comes from Old Middle French, which means to sum up your life. At the outset, it's important to note that there is no one right way to write a resume. I've seen many excellent resumes through the years that use entirely different layouts and formats. However, all resumes must include certain basic elements to be effective. You'll also have a cover letter which typically accompanies your resume and a list of references, and these will include other details. So how long should a resume be? Typically, a resume will be one page for things like job fairs, and perhaps two pages for a sit-down interview, and very rarely three pages. If you need more than two pages, it's advisable to write a CV or curriculum vitae. We'll talk about that more later in a separate presentation. Well, here's a typical representative sort of resume. You'll notice it's divided into sections. There's a letterhead at the top, and it includes both bullets and long prose text. It's sometimes helpful to think about a resume in terms of whether you want to write a resume to be read for speed, such as using bullets and very short sentences, or whether you're expecting your reader to sit down and really digest the details in longer, complete sentences. This is a personal choice. The general difference is that you'll want to have a shorter, more speedy resume for things like job fairs, but perhaps a slightly longer format for sit-down interviews. Normally, the first thing we encounter at the very top of a resume is a letterhead, and the first thing we see typically is your name, usually in enlarged or bold letters. The font used there could be different than the rest of your resume to help it stand out, and also because many people go by their middle name or perhaps a nickname, you can include this with parentheses and quote marks in your resume letterhead so that people know that you're typically called by a slightly different name. Do you need to include a pronoun like Mr., Ms., or Miss? This is entirely up to you. And the same goes for adding junior or the third or even the fourth. If that's the way you sign your name, then you should probably put it on your resume. All resumes should include a current up-to-date mailing address. This can be either an actual residential or business address, or perhaps a post office box. If you're in the United States, you should use the standard U.S. Postal Service format. And if you work overseas, of course, that format must be adopted to what you're using there in that nation. The telephone number is one of the most important details on a letterhead. Typically, companies, after interviewing all their candidates, will create what's known as a short list of all their best candidates, and they'll typically start at the top of their candidate list and work their way down. If you don't have a phone number, they may not call you. They prefer phone numbers typically because they need an answer and they want people to know that if one person refuses a job, that someone else will be next to be asked. They may not have time to wait for a text or an email. So the take-home lesson here is include a phone number. Also, when you're in a period of interviewing, make sure you check your outgoing voicemail messages. They should be clear and concise and not too silly. One of the things we talk about in all document design is editorial consistency. And this goes for things like phone numbers. There are many ways to present phone numbers. They can be using the traditional parentheses for area codes, followed by a three-number prefix, a dash, and a four-number suffix. This is the traditional way in the United States for doing phone numbers, but it's also perfectly correct and acceptable to use periods or dashes. Well, whatever you do when listing phone numbers for yourself and employers, or any contacts that you have on a reference sheet, use the same format throughout. I'm going to show you a few samples that are taken from Louise Kurzmark's book, Best Resumes for College Students and New Grads. It's a useful reference, and I highly recommend it. It's published by JIST. Here's an unusual resume. It's unusual because the first thing we notice are these graphics on the upper left corner. Resumes are generally not good for graphics. If you have graphics that you want to use, you might think carefully about why you're using them and only apply them when you have a very good reason. Another unusual thing about this particular resume is this column on the left, which is a sort of compendium of highlights of details that are located in the body of the resume. This is a very, very speedily read type resume. This would be perhaps ideal for a job fair or for one of those very quick job employment opportunities where you only have a few moments to talk to a prospective employer. You don't need to have an objective on your resume again. It's entirely optional. But when you do have a resume, make certain that it's tuned to the objective for your audience. You need to think about what your prospective employer needs from you. Make sure that your objective is not too general, nor too specific. If it's too general, it may not provide any useful information. It may just sound generic. And if it's too specific, it may sound like you're only good at doing one thing. Make sure you study the job description. Here's another resume. You'll notice that this one is laid out with the use of lines. The lines help divide the page into various sections. They aid the eye as it travels across the page. You'll also notice the use of bolding and headings in order to organize this resume into a more readable document. Now here's a quick trivia question about the previous resume. How many jobs did this person have? Well, it sure looked like they'd had a lot of experience. Here's the surprise. This particular person has only had one job. I bring this up because a lot of students find that they don't have a great deal of experience and they don't want to just put a bare page out for a resume. So what can you do? Well, this particular person has decided to detail the various tasks and subtasks of their position so they give the reader a better idea of what they've done. Now let's talk about your education section. For most students, since they are students and they're employed in education, as it were, this is the most important part of their life then. So it's usually near the top of the resume. In older, more experienced applicants, it may be located further down. Like all sections where we're listing things, we're going to use a reverse chronological order, starting at the top with the highest and most recent educational level, and working our way down to older, more previous institutions where you've gone to school. Make sure that you list important scholarships and awards. And if you wish to add your high school, this should only be done probably in the first 3 years of your college career. After that, only list high school details that are extraordinary. Here's a professional dilemma. Should you include your GPA? After all, grade point average is important to you as a student. Isn't it important to employers? Well, this is a complex question, and I'm going to take a few minutes just to talk about this. It's a question I get all the time from students. It's important to notice that large employers, say Microsoft or Google, frequently use GPA to filter out massive numbers of first-time applicants. It's not unusual for them to get thousands of applicants for the same job. They need a quick way to filter through them, and they know that they may be sacrificing excellent applicants, but it's one of the methods that they may use to rake off large numbers of applicants. On the other hand, many smaller companies may never ask about your GPA, nor whether you need to show them a transcript of your college career. It depends on the job and the employer. One thing's almost for certain. After your first long-term job, and some years thereafter, you'll probably never be asked about your college GPA. It becomes largely irrelevant because it's eclipsed by your experience. Here's something to think about from the employer's perspective. First of all, there's the matter of grade inflation, and I'm going to show you some data from Stuart Roysachter at the Washington Post. It was updated up until about 4 years ago with the help of Chris Healy. And then we're also going to talk about how GPA varies by major and discipline. And these data come from Lynn O'Shaughnessy, courtesy of CBS News from 2010, compiled from other data taken by Wake Forest University. In the long-term trend of grade inflation, it's notable that this has gone on for quite some time. Since World War II, grades have increased. You'll notice that A's have steadily gone up, and the number of B's has been about flat or slightly reduced, as have C's. D's and F's, on the other hand, have only slightly dropped. So what does this mean? Are people getting smarter? Are schools getting easier? Here's a grouping by public versus private schools, and then both taken together. And this is taken for an interval at the end of the 20th and early 21st centuries. You'll notice again that the trend is upward. GPAs have climbed every year, end over end. This also varies, however, by institution. My home institution, UC Santa Barbara, is the next to the rightmost listing here on this bar chart. So it's had a little less grade inflation than those on the left. The uptick in A's began shortly after the Vietnam War. It was a sharp increase, and then it was a more steady increase from the late 70s on. Now let's think about GPA versus the major or discipline. When an employer is looking at your resume and they're considering your GPA, they also need to be reminded, probably by you, that different majors have different standards for what's considered a good GPA. Consider, for example, the five lowest grade point averages: chemistry, math, economics, psychology, and biology. Does this mean that students from these disciplines are stupid or less capable of learning? Of course not. These are some of the hardest majors. On the other hand, those in the five highest grade point average category, education, language, English, music, and religion, are not representing students that are overly intelligent or extraordinarily smart compared to their STEM cohorts. They're just simply in an area that tends to give out higher grades. Here are the take-home lessons. Whether to put GPA on your resume or not is entirely up to you. It's a personal disclosure that you can choose to put on or leave off. If you, however, have an extraordinarily good GPA, why not put it on there? It does vary greatly by major and institution, and there has been a very long-term trend toward ever higher GPAs since at least World War II. Let's talk about the next section. Employment or experience. Like the education section, your job should be listed in reverse chronological order, starting with the newest at the top and working down toward the oldest. You want to list the employers that are most relevant to the job for which you're applying. It's helpful to exclude trivial and part-time jobs that don't pertain at all. And you should never pad your resume with things that either are irrelevant to the job you're applying for, and certainly not those that are embellished upon or outright lies. For example, if you've had a job title as a forklift operator, don't put vertical storage engineer. You need to describe your responsibilities in the employment section for each job. And if you've ever worked for an employer that has an abbreviated name like IBM, you should spell it out in your listing. International Business Machines for IBM, for example. When you're listing larger employers, make sure you mention the division or department. Some of these are global networks and they are vast. IBM, for example, has offices and divisions around the world. So make sure you list the division where you worked. Also, if you've ever worked at a company that's been bought, sold, or merged with other companies, the name may have changed, and you should list the new name even if it's not the name you worked under when you were there. You can also put the old name in parentheses alongside the new name. Let's look at another resume. This resume also has a graphic on the upper left, probably not necessary. And this person has chosen to replace the typical word of skills with competencies. Does this confer an advantage? Something to think about. Here's yet another one. This one uses a two-column format, somewhat reminiscent of, say, a newspaper or a magazine. The shorter lines are easier to follow with your eye. It makes them a little bit more readable, but you'll also notice that this forces the layout to have headings that are out of position or out of alignment with one another. Again, this is largely a matter of personal aesthetics and your sense of organization and layout. But like the use of graphics, or hopefully absence thereof, you should know why you're making these editorial choices. Notice also here that there are checked highlights of qualifications and that these are written in a third-person voice. Let's talk about that. What should you use? First person or third person? In the first person voice, we hear things like, I worked as, or I built this. They're given from a personal perspective. They're often very personable in their tone, and they may seem more honest and more authentic. After all, they're coming directly from you to the reader. On the other hand, some prefer the third person voice. Worked as, built such and such. It gives the point of view of an objective observer, but really you're not fooling anyone. The reader knows you wrote the resume. So be careful. A third-person description can sound a little pontificating and sometimes even arrogant. So, as you make these choices, like all others, know why you're making them. Have a reason. Let's talk about now things that you do not include on a resume. These are exclusions. Your availability for a job is something you should discuss either in your cover letter or during the interview. Also, your reasons for leaving a previous job. These should always be left for the interview, particularly when they've been under duress or due to conflicts with former supervisors. Your references should be listed on a separate document that uses the same letterhead as your resume and your cover letter, including 2 to 4 references with their contact information and a very brief 2 or 3 sentence description of what they know about you. Also, be sure to call your references before you list them. Written testimonials, such as personal letters of reference, are good to add to your portfolio, which you can carry with you when you go on a job interview. But don't attach them to your resume unless specifically asked for them, and make sure to always give them a copy, not the original. Salary is something I'll talk about separately in just a moment. More exclusions include esoteric jargon and abbreviations. They may help you sound like an insider or expert, but if they're overdone, they can sound very pedantic. Keep them to a resume minimum. Photographs should go in your portfolio. They may be helpful. It could be showing your reader or your interviewer what exactly you've done on the job, but they should not be directly printed onto your resume. Again, use all graphics sparingly and only when you have a reason. Details regarding age, race, religion, national origin, sexual orientation are protected by law as confidential. You do not need to disclose any of this information. Your health and physical descriptions are probably not going to be helpful either. Childhood details, your weaknesses or demands, and certainly lies and exaggerations should all be kept off a resume. So, let's assume your resume is in hand and it's ready to go to work. You've had your interview, and they like you, and you like them. Remember, interviews work both ways. What are you going to do now? Well, probably the first thing you'll do is negotiate your salary, unless it's a fixed position with a fixed job salary. When you're negotiating a salary, you need to think about your position and the level of expertise you have coming in. Generally, the least experienced people get the lowest pay. Also, you need to think about your geographical location. This varies widely, as we'll see. Also, be prepared to negotiate your salary per your requirements and needs. More about that. Let's take an example between two mechanical engineers, one in Santa Barbara and one in St. Paul. And we'll assume that both of these engineers are first-time applicants. They're fresh out of college and they've never worked in industry full-time as engineers before. Which one's going to earn more? Well, if we look at data from salary.com, a website I highly recommend for your salary survey, you'll notice that in this case, the job pays about the same in either city. In fact, they're within mere dollars of each other. But here's where things really begin to diverge. When we consider cost of living, particularly things like housing, there could be a vast difference between a place like Santa Barbara and St. Paul, Minnesota. I'm going to show you some data from bestplaces.com, another very valuable and helpful website. Here's the cost of living in Santa Barbara. This is as of 2020. You'll notice, first of all, that the thing that stands out is the housing. Housing in Santa Barbara is notoriously expensive. In fact, it's 5 times the national average. The national average, which is normalized in bestplaces.com as a 100 score, that is, a 100 represents the national average cost, is increased by 5 times for housing in Santa Barbara. You'll notice the median home price in Santa Barbara is over $1 million, whereas the national average is less than $250,000. This gives an overall cost of living index in Santa Barbara of more than twice the national average. That means that for that mechanical engineer who's applying for a job, they're going to be paying a lot of money out for their housing and their other expenses. Let's compare it with St. Paul, Minnesota. You'll notice that the median age for both Santa Barbara and St. Paul are almost exactly the same. They're within months of each other. The unemployment rates are similar, and the commute times don't vary all that much. The average home price, on the other hand, is quite different. Let's look at the specific cost of living in St. Paul, Minnesota. First of all, notice that here on the right, we have our national expenses, normalized for a score of 100. And then as we look toward St. Paul, you'll see that St. Paul's a really good baseline city to use in terms of national averages. They're very close to the national average overall. Less than 1%, in fact. Groceries, housing, utilities are almost the same, and others vary only slightly. Look at housing. Housing in St. Paul is almost exactly the national average, and the overall score is about on par with the national average. So, take-home lessons is, regardless of the salary you're being offered, you need to compare it against the cost of living where you'll be living while you're working, and always consider alongside that the quality of life. That includes the housing, local businesses that you'd be using, schools for your children if you're planning on having kids, the commute times to get to and from work, and what we might think of as the general feng shui of the environment and local life where you'd be planning on living. You need to share your key monthly expenses with your prospective employer when you sit down to negotiate your salary. I recommend having this researched and written out in advance. Why, you may say? Well, for one thing, the person you're interviewing is probably older. They may not have had a reality check in a while for what it really costs to live there. Their salary may be so high at this point that they don't notice the finer details such as you do as a beginning, starting out professional. You need to educate them. If you negotiate a salary or agree to one and it's below your living cost, you're already in trouble. That job is now costing you money, and it's bad for you and your employer. Underpaid employees have higher turnover and higher rates of sick leave. They cost employers more to train because they leave more frequently. Make sure you study the cost of living for a given location and then make a monthly budget. I've put links in the comments below so that you can check those references yourself. Make sure to include housing and utilities, food, and consider in food whether you're going to be dining in and cooking from groceries that you've purchased, or dining out, which can be very expensive. Also, transportation costs. Are you going to use local mass transit when it's available, or will you own a car and have car payments, insurance, and gas expenses? Also, consider health care. It's a huge part of your monthly expenses. Any student loan payments that begin after graduation, and the amount of money you intend to save each month, along with incidentals like entertainment, travel, vacation expenses, and such. When you add all these up, you get your bottom line monthly expenses. And here's the caveat. Don't let expenses exceed your income. If they do, there's a formula for debt. And debt means game over. You won't be able to stay in the job for very long. You may even have to move from the area that you've chosen to live in. What if your employer cannot or will not pay you what you need to live on? What can you do besides refuse the job? You might be able to negotiate a pay increase agreement that's performance-based after an initial review period. Lots of new jobs have this, a so-called probationary period. You can ask about that and ask to be paid more after a period of, say, 3 or 4 months after you've demonstrated your value to the company. You can also negotiate for benefits or perks. What sorts of perks, you may ask? Well, you might be able to negotiate when you work, how much vacation leave you have, whether and when you're allowed to telecommute, an office, a company car, particularly if you must travel for your job, your travel and expenses, and anything else can be put on the negotiation table. Here's the bottom line, too. If you don't toot your horn, who will? When you're first approaching a job, it's no time to be shy or reticent. You need to be ready and willing to negotiate the details. You need to do it right at the start while you're interviewing, not after you've accepted a job. Communicate clearly exactly what you want and share the expenses you know you'll have to pay in order to fulfill your long-term plans. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me, the writing program at the University of California, Santa Barbara. I hope this has been helpful. Thank you.